Introduction on who I am. So for those of you who were here last night, sorry, you get to go through it twice. But greetings from New York. So I'll give you the very quickly sort of who I am and where I come from to put it in context. As Farka said, they call me the Global Director of Brand Intelligence. That is sort of the agency fancy name for the guy who does research and insights, but that's the name they want to call me. J. Walter Thompson is, depending on which list you look at, third or fourth largest ad agency in the world. It's about $1.5 billion in billings. We have about 100 and something offices around the world in more countries than I can name. But most of my career, I spent on the research side of the business, working for companies that do just specifically research on a contract basis, trying to understand and solve clients' marketing problems through talking to consumers. I'm an adjunct at Columbia and NYU, teaching in a graduate program on integrated marketing and strategic communications. And I'm also on the board of the AEF, the ANA's Advertising Educational Foundation, which is a body that tries to bridge between the world of academia, students, and the marketing and advertising industries. I live out on Long Island, which is a big landmass right off of Manhattan. Manhattan is right here. All right, so I do this commute every day. You would think it doesn't look that far, but with mass transit, that's almost a 2-hour commute each way. Living in New York can be difficult. I'm a big music fan. I said last night, these are things that we used to call record albums, for those of you who don't know what they are. And in my spare time, I play in a band. That's an old picture of me. We're a bunch of research guys, so we call ourselves the Outliers. Get it? It's a joke. All right, so how do consumers make decisions? I think we know, but we don't know, and I have a little game we're gonna play, but I gotta find my game first. Okay. We think memory and how memory works is sort of like a videotape machine, right? We experience something, we remember it, and when we want to recall it, we just sort of call it back and hit the play button, and back comes the messaging. But that's not really how memory works at all, right? So we're gonna play a little game. I'm gonna read you 17 words, yeah? For those of you who have pencil and paper with you, what I'm gonna ask you to do is after I read the 17th word, I want you to write down as many of those words as you can remember. Okay? You all got paper and pencil ready? But you can't start writing until I say the last word. I'll tell you when to go. Ready? Here are the words. Sugary, candy, happy, lollipop, good, taste, syrupy, sugar, nice, honey, cavity, soda, chocolate, heart, cake, saccharin, pie. How'd we do? On average, people get 7 of the 17 words. So So if you're somewhere in that ballpark, you're close. People tend to remember the first three very well, and they tend to remember some of the last couple, but they get confused in between. So I'm going to ask you a couple of them. How many had sugary? That was the first one. Very good. How many had candy? How many had sweet? About a quarter of you. Okay. I never said sweet, right? What I did was I said everything that your brain associates with sweet except sweet, right? And I've done this before. If I made you write down 17 of them, you all would have had sweet on that list, right? What that's doing is it's activating your latent associations with the term sweet, right? I talked about this a bit last night. If you say the term, say the word BMW, within a half a second, people will associate it with all the terms and words they've ever associated with BMW before. German, engineering, high quality, Autobahn, all these things, right? What we did here was we did it the opposite way. We were trying to get to sweet, and we activated all those other words around that, right? And your brain automatically fills in the gap with the word that it's highly associated with. This is how our brains tend to think about topics, ideas, and stimuli, right? We create a sense of meaning, and this is kind of how advertising works, right? If you're selling a product, what you're trying to do is create all those other words that people associate with it, and hopefully you're creating associations with words that are desirable and motivational to get people to pick up your brand. Okay, we'll go play another little game, a little card trick before I do that. So I'm going to show you five cards. I want you to pick one really quickly and stare at it for 10 seconds and memorize that card. Everything about that card. Okay? All right, go. We'll shuffle them. And I'm going to find your card. And I'm going to take it away. Okay? Did your card go away? Yeah? Okay. The reason it went away is because none of those cards were up there before. Right? And this is an exercise in the behavioral economic theory of attentional blindness, which is when you force someone to focus on one thing, they do it to the exclusion of everything else. Yeah? There's a famous book that was written, there's a video online, you've probably seen it, about the gorilla and the basketball players. Have you seen that one? If you haven't seen it, you can look it up online, about attentional blindness. What they do in the video is there's a team with white t-shirts and a team with black t-shirts, and you're supposed to count the number of times the team in white passes the basketball. That's your task, right? So you're counting, one, two. And in the middle of it, a guy walks out in a gorilla suit and goes, and then walks off screen. And only about half of people see the gorilla until you tell them. And they're like, oh, my God, how did I miss the gorilla, right? That is a function of attentional blindness. And this happens to us all the time. When our brains have limited capacity to focus on multiple things at a time. And when we focus it on one thing, we do it to the exclusion of others. There have been tests done where they have shown people an incident, a car accident. But people were given different tasks at the same time. This group had to look at the car coming in this direction. This group had to look at the car coming in that direction. This group had to look at the traffic light. And all three groups describe the car accident completely differently because of what they're focusing on, right? But we believe, because our reality is what we think we experience, that our way is right. But often it's not. The point of this is that our brain doesn't always function in the way that we like to think it does. It functions in ways that are predictable, but often incorrect. And I want to show you a little bit about how that works in marketing. So if you've been in the marketing world at all, you've probably seen this model, the IATA model, right? It stands for you create awareness, you create interest, that generates desire, and that leads to action. All right, it's been around for quite some time. It's actually been around for 120 years, which was the same year that China leased Hong Kong to the British, right, which is now back under Chinese rule. The roller coaster was patented, the first auto insurance policy was sold, and New York City became a city. So it's been around for quite a long time. It was developed by MetLife in the life insurance industry to sell personal selling techniques, one-on-one, for new products. The marketing industry largely teaches this as a way of doing mass communication, not one-to-one, but one-to-many. There's some problems with this model. It assumes that a single medium, be that a television ad, an outdoor ad, social media, has an isolated effect on everything else you've ever thought about. It ignores Jerry Zaltman's concept of co-creation. Jerry Zaltman is a professor emeritus at Harvard, and he wrote a book called How Consumers Think. And in there, he talked about this concept of co-creation, which means that when I see a message from a brand, what I ultimately internalize in my brain is a co-created response to what you said and what I already thought about you. The old model, the IATA model, sort of assumes you will ingest my message and you will dutifully play it back to me, exactly as I gave it to you. That's not the way the brain works at all. Its emphasis is on short-term sales, not building brand equity. And it assumes there's kind of a start and a finish every time we go through this process. That we have to start at the beginning, we have to go through each step every time we make a new purchase, that there's a blank slate every time, and that we are rational beings. And that's the biggest fallacy of this model, that we are rational, because we are not rational. This model, when you think about it, would argue that one of the things we need to do is make an impact on people, break through, capture their attention. I'm going to show you an ad that VW ran. Let's see if this works.
She just gives me the feeling like she's not like listening to me.
Have you tried not saying like every other word?
What?
How do I get the sound on here?
Do I have to do this? Would that work? Is it up on the screen now?
Yeah.
No, it's still only on him.
Talk amongst yourselves.
Do we need to turn this on right there?
What if I put this on there? All right, so this is a short ad for Volkswagen that they ran maybe 5-10 years ago.
Just gives me the feeling like she's not like listening to me.
Have you tried not saying like every other word?
What?
Remember your ski trip story?
Yeah.
I was like going down the hill and like this guy like cut me like, look, stuff either happens or it doesn't happen. Stuff doesn't sort of like happen.
I show that ad because if you're all about getting breakthrough, catching people's attention, that catches people's attention. Well, I'll tell you about a piece of research we did. Ford Motor Company is one of our clients, and they were looking at an ad that was designed to demonstrate the safety of the Ford F-150, which is their profit driver in their business, right? And the ad they had showed a Ford F-150 on a test lot, and a voiceover comes over and starts talking about all of the safety features of the truck, right? Steel reinforced, roll cage, blah, 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 all this stuff. And while he's talking, two bulldozers pull up and start crushing the truck, right? And then you hear one of those industrial sounds. And the doors open, and four engineers get out of the truck, safe, right? Ford F-150, built Ford tough, beauty shot on the mountain, logo, end of spot, right? And they had another spot that was the same exact visuals, but instead of the voiceover, it had a chamber orchestra playing this nice little music, right? And when they tested the ads, time and time again, people would say to them, I don't know what it is about that ad, but I don't like it. And they couldn't articulate what it was about the ad that they didn't like, right? Working with Ford, we used a fairly new research technique, which is a biometric technique. You literally put people in an fMRI machine, and you measure which parts of the brain are being activated when they see the spot. And for every single person who saw it, one region of the brain kept lighting up, and it was the fear center of the brain. Subconsciously, what they were thinking when they saw that ad is, oh my God, you crushed that truck with people in there? What are you, nuts? You could have hurt them. And there was this sense of protectionism, this sense of, you know, oh my God, that's scary. That, the thing they couldn't articulate is what was becoming that latent association with them. They were subconsciously associating in their brain Ford and fear. That's not what you want the brand to be associated with, right? When VW ran this ad, they were trying to do the same thing. They were trying to show you how safe the car was. But that's not what people came away with, right? When you watch that ad, it's very jarring. It's like, oh my God, right? And that's the lasting impression that people get. And people are associating VW with fear, with accidents. It's why for 40 years, no auto company ever showed real people in an accident. They showed crash test dummies, because it's less emotive, right? I don't know why this isn't. Because this is open, maybe. There we go. So we think about that IATA model. There are a lot of other models out there that try and explain how people make decisions for purchase, right? There's a need recognition. We search for information. We evaluate alternatives. We make a decision. We use the product. McKinsey has a similar model, has a little loop in the middle of it. Dr. Norcross, Prochaska, and DiClemente have a similar model about how we change our behavior. The theme with these is they're all very linear, and they all sort of move in a stepwise pattern, when the truth is the process looks something more like that. It's not linear. It's not clean. I don't think about it every time I do it. I have information. It's swirling around me all the time. If you shortcut this model and say it's really about, I think about something, awareness, I feel something, interest and desire, and then I do something, I take an action, right? You can shortcut it to I think, I feel, I do. I think this model is broken. I don't think it works. I don't think it works today. I don't think it worked 120 years ago, right? I think more often, this is the way the model works. I feel something, I think about it, and I do it. And more often, I think it's this model. I feel something, I act on it, and then I post-rationalize what I did. And then I put it on Facebook. Yeah. But this is the key change. The key change is that it doesn't start with a rational decision. It starts with some sort of emotional response to stimuli. Where did this thinking come from? The human brain processes roughly 11 million bits of information every second. Every second. Right now, your brain knows what the big toe on your right foot feels like in your right shoe. It knows that. It's tracking that information. You're not tracking it consciously unless you focus on it, right? Because if you did, our brains don't have the capacity to handle that. Our brains, our rational brains, only have the capacity to handle about 40 bits of information a second, which means the vast majority of information that our brain is processing is happening largely outside of the range of our awareness. We're not even aware that our brains are processing certain information, most of it, in fact. Where did this thinking come from? Over the last 20 years or so, there's been a ton of advancement in the understanding of how the brain works, specifically the role of the subconscious and the role of emotion in decision making. And if you're sort of interested in this topic, that's a pretty good reading list. It started with the book in the top right corner, Antonio Damasio's book, Descartes' Error, right? And he talks about it, you know, René Descartes, the philosopher, right? He said, I think, therefore I am. He also said, we are of two minds, a rational mind and an emotional mind. And the rational mind is what differentiates us from all the other species on the planet. It keeps our emotions in check. It keeps us from acting impulsively. There's a famous case in psychology of a guy named Phineas Gage, who was a New England railroad iron worker, right? And the story is that he was just sort of a normal guy, going to work every day, doing his thing. And then one day, he had a worksite accident, and he took a railroad spike through the head. And it was a big spike, like a 6-foot spike. This guy toured the country after this, him and his spike, right? And he recovered. And when he came back to work, his coworkers noticed something had changed dramatically about him. Whereas before, he was just sort of a normal guy going to work. Now suddenly, he struggled to make even the most basic of decisions. Couldn't decide which color socks to wear. Couldn't decide whether he wanted coffee or tea in the morning. Couldn't decide which way to drive to work in the morning, right? And they wondered, why would it be that a guy who had damage to the emotional part of his brain, because where he suffered the problem was the prefrontal cortex, which is where a lot of emotions get processed. Why would it be if he suffered damage to the emotional part of his brain, would he have trouble making rational decisions? And Damasio posited that perhaps emotions play a larger role in decisions than we had originally thought. That's kind of where all this started. There's been a ton of work done on this over the last 20 years. And the basic accepted nomenclature within psychology today, the theory, is that indeed emotions play a more significant role than rational decision making. Patients with damage to emotional parts of the brain cannot make decisions despite having no change in IQ. Charles Duhigg, who's a journalist for the New York Times, wrote this book maybe 5 years ago. And in there, he writes about another patient who had a brain injury, Eugene, who had a virus that destroyed his short-term memory. Couldn't remember anything that had happened in the past 24 to 48 hours, and as a function of that, also lost his ability to do basic tasks. Put a key in a lock, fry an egg, tie his shoes, right? So during his rehab, they had a nurse come in every morning and teach him these things. And every morning when the nurse came in, he would introduce himself to her. "Hi, I'm Eugene. Nice to meet you. Why are you here?" Had no recollection of having met her. This went on for 3 months. Every day, 90 days, "Hi, I'm Eugene. Who are you? Nice to meet you," right? On the 91st day, while he still had no recollection of ever having met this woman, he learned the content. He learned how to fry an egg. He learned how to tie his shoes. He learned how to put a key in the lock. That's all that subconscious learning, stuff that is happening outside of the range of our awareness. As a researcher, one of the questions we always ask people are, do you remember seeing an ad for, fill in the blank, Coca-Cola? And when I read this, I started thinking, that's a stupid question. We shouldn't be asking that. It doesn't matter whether they remember seeing the ad. What matters is what did they internalize as a function of having seen the ad. Right? Because the brain doesn't really work that way. People don't sit down and watch a commercial and you're watching something on TV one night and you keep a list of all the different brands you saw advertised. People don't do that. Right? It just sort of happens to you or it doesn't. Let's try and show this video. We'll see if we can get the sound good enough on this one. This is about a 6-minute video. I have no sound, so I'm just trying to
knowing that we will register so much unconsciously.
Okay, sorry for the audio problems, but take a listen.
I invited two members of MBA, an advertising agency, to a secret location to propose an unusual task. Those who work in advertising are masters of persuasion. They subtly weave their images and slogans into our daily lives, knowing that we will register so much unconsciously. And then we walk into a supermarket and feel a sense of familiarity with a product we think we've never heard of. Millions of pounds a year are spent on it. It's brilliantly calculated, and we all fall for it. So I thought I'd turn the tables on the advertising experts. Thank you for joining us, gentlemen. Tony, yes?
Yes.
And Martin?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Darren. Let me get down to explaining exactly what I want you to do. Imagine that I'm opening a chain of stores selling a product, something I have a particular interest in. Your task is to come up with a poster advertising that store. And that poster must include the company name, whatever you decide that may be. It must include a strap line, some sort of slogan, and some kind of logo as well. Now, the idea is you've only got half an hour to do this, so you've got to really work with your first instinct. So at the moment, you've got no idea what you're going to do, correct?
Yeah.
Excellent. I'm also going to give you this. I've had a few design ideas of my own. We'll leave this untouched. We'll come back to that later. All right? Are there any questions?
What's the product?
What's the product? Very good question. Passion of mine since I was a toddler. It's a chain of taxidermy stores. Let me pop the pussycat on the envelope so it remains untouched. You have half an hour, gentlemen. Good luck.
Thanks. Thanks. It's perfect.
Get it started as a start.
Animal hospital. The ones who didn't make it. No, that's probably just... stupid. Doing wings.
Well, creatures great is more quality that says like nice, positive type of animals.
Yeah.
Animal heaven. Where animals go.
Animal heaven, that's good.
Graveyard.
Animal heaven's good. Where the best animals go to.
Loads of clouds with animals on them.
Gates,
early gates, bear playing the harp.
Yeah. Only the best
Zoo.
Get into air.
Yeah. Where dead animals go to live. Where
the best place for dead animals? Simple.
Time up, gentlemen. Okay. I can't wait to see what you've done. Come on, Shirley.
Okay.
And Tony, before we do this, can you take the envelope we gave you earlier?
Okay.
And can you please vouch for us here that no one's been anywhere near it? It's been under a dead cat. No one's touched it.
That's right.
That's the truth.
That's the truth.
Keep on with it. Come around here. Now, before we have a look at it, just tell me, what was it like?
We started off thinking about the name. We thought that was probably the best thing to
do. Starting point.
Sure.
And then take it from there, really. We banged out a load of ones that were probably completely stupid. And then got down to the ones that were slightly stupid.
Mm-hmm.
And then we kind of, that went back and forth for a bit, and then kind of got something we liked and developed it.
Can I have a look?
Sure.
Sure.
This is?
Yeah.
That's fantastic. It's a bear with a lion.
So it's animal heaven, the best place for dead animals.
And it's obviously, you'd see that it was stuffed.
How did you come up with the name animal heaven?
We had the idea of the pearly gates of heaven being a zoo gate.
Zoo gates as the gates of heaven, that's interesting.
I.e. sort of all the animals that are dead are in the dead zoo, if you like, in heaven. And then we just kind of thought, well, it's kind of nice, but it's a bit twee. We wanted to make it a bit funkier. And then we thought a hard-playing bear just answered the brief.
That's fantastic. I do want to show you my own ideas from beforehand.
Okay.
I don't want to touch. Would you open them for me?
Sure.
And where is...
I think you'll find this interesting. Miles away. Let me put this up there. Hang on to that. It's a heart-playing bear.
Yeah.
God.
You've gone for these angel wings here. Were you thinking of angel wings or bird wings?
Yeah. Well, they were kind of a combination.
You do them a lot better than me. This was the same thing. I was thinking angel wings there. You've got animal heaven. I got creature heaven.
Yeah.
Where the best...
You're a bit off there, then.
A bit off there. Where the best dead animals go.
God.
You put blessed place for dead animals. Very similar. I had the idea of a zoo gate on there.
It was hard to leave out.
We didn't want
to
overload it.
It was hard to leave out, but it was just a bit too much.
Can I see your the other one you were talking about?
Yeah, it's just before then.
Is it very different?
Well, it's just the gates.
Yeah.
Oh, gentlemen, please.
It's all quite similar.
Look at that. This was the image I was thinking. I've done it there in the background, because this to me was the more striking image, and interestingly, you abandoned this for this one. This was
The first bear I drew looks exactly like that one.
It did.
The first bear you drew.
Yeah, shall I show you on the...
Shall we? Shall we? What have you got?
Well, this is scary, really.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
Look at that. Look at the cloud, you got the blue. If you knew the amount of effort we've gone into making this work, you'd be absolutely flabbergasted. But for now, it's comforting to know that you're just as susceptible to subliminal persuasion as the rest of us. Thank you very much, sir. Helping yourself. Sorry,
thank you,
Martin.
Pleasure.
Take care. Thank you
Thanks.
Very much indeed.
I'm quite cynical. When I saw the bear and I saw a cloud, first of all, behind the paper, I thought, hanging these clothes here. And then when we saw the rest of it, couldn't believe it.
I immediately thought, oh, I'm gutted. I could see that it was folded, and I just saw the bear's foot hanging over the cloud with a harp.
Yeah.
I just thought, oh, I can't believe it.
Yeah. It was kind of embarrassing.
But now I think, oh, fantastic, and I'm over the moon.
Oh, obviously we're pleased for him,
He
comes out of this looking good, then that's always the main thing.
To see how we did it, watch their taxi journey again.
I put a spell on you. Cause you're mine. Things you do. I ain't lying. No,
There's two things going on in that video that I think are particularly interesting, right? One of them is what we call priming. Is that better? So priming, right, is the effect that I give you a sense of things, but it's being processed beyond the range of your awareness, right? That's what happened to them, right? They were sort of planted, all these ideas. That's what communications is about. That's what advertising is about. That's what advertising does, is it subtly gives us a sense of meaning, and we're not even aware that it's happening. From a research point of view, what's interesting about it is when he asked them, how did they come up with this idea? And we know how they came up with it. Literally, it was put there, right? But they couldn't say that. They couldn't say, I don't know. It was just there. The idea just came to me. They did what all consumers do. They came up with what we call the justifying narrative, the plausible explanation for what happened, even though that's not what happened. And that's why in research, we need to be really clever about how to get past that sort of veneer, past that sort of shadowy reflection of what truth is and reality is, and move to something that's a little more explanatory. Dan Ariely from Duke University wrote a book called Predictably Irrational, which is a great book. And in there he says, if I were to distill the one main lesson from the research in this book, it's that we people are pawns in a game whose forces we largely fail to comprehend. We usually think of ourselves as sitting in the driver's seat with ultimate control over the decisions we make and the direction our life takes. But that perception has more to do with our desires, how we want to see ourselves as people, than with reality. Daniel Kahneman, who won a Nobel Prize for his work on understanding how decisions get made, in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, he says, when you're asked what you're thinking about, you can normally answer. You believe you know what goes on in your mind, which is usually one conscious thought leading in an orderly way to another conscious thought. But that's not the only way the mind works, nor is it the typical way. Most impressions and thoughts arise in our conscious brain without us having any idea how they got there. They're just there. Damasio sums up his work saying, people, we are not thinking machines that have the capability to feel. Rather, we are feeling machines that have developed the capability of thinking. J.P. Morgan knew this 100 years ago. He said, a man makes a decision for two reasons, the good reason and the real reason. The good reason is the one we often hear in the first few minutes of research. The real reason is the one we're after, the one that really motivates people to do things. When Kahneman talks about the brain, he talks about the rational and the emotional subconscious brain as system one and system two thinking. System one being the subconscious brain, system two being the rational brain. System one, the subconscious, happens implicitly. We don't know it's happening. It happens much faster than our rational thinking. We know how to do it from the moment we're born. It's intuitive to us. We think in metaphors, and it's completely unconscious. Our rational brain, by comparison, is very explicit. We know we're doing it. It's slow. It's analytical. We learn how to do it. It's propositional, and it's very conscious, right? There is an evolutionary basis for why we think this way. If you imagine the tribesman on the Serengeti 10,000 years ago, and he hears something rustling in the bushes, the tribesman who stopped and thought, gee, I wonder if that's a tiger. Gee, I wonder if the tiger is hungry and I wonder if the tiger saw me. We did not descend from that tribesman, right? Because he got eaten by the tiger. Our great-great-great-great-grandfather was the tribesman who threw his spear up in the air and said, oh, shit, a tiger, and ran away. That's our descendant, right? It is a built-in safety mechanism to react emotionally. When you're driving to work in the morning, and in between two cars, a red ball comes bouncing out, and you slam on the brakes, that did not happen using System 2 thinking. You didn't say, ball, gee, I wonder if a kid's coming out, lift up legs, step on brake, apply pressure. You didn't do that. Your body just reacted. That's your limbic system, your emotional system, because it keeps us safe. Whenever you see any reaction, any stimulus, anything, within the first half of a second, you have an emotional reaction to that. Then you start thinking about it. Yeah? But the system one emotion takes place significantly quickly. One of my friends at NYU talks about this in a way I like. Our emotional side is like an elephant, and our rational side is like its rider. The rider seems to be the leader, seems to be in control, but that control is precarious. Because any time the rider and the 6-ton elephant have a disagreement about which way to go, the elephant normally wins that argument, right? And that's the same way with our emotions. Einstein knew this. The intuitive mind is a sacred gift, and the rational mind is the faithful servant. We've created a society that honors the servant and has forgotten about the gift. Rory Sutherland, who runs a behavioral economics practice for Ogilvy and Mather out of the UK, he says the conscious rational brain isn't the Oval Office. It isn't there making executive decisions in our mind. It's actually the press office issuing explanations for behaviors we've already taken. And I saw him at a conference a few years ago, and he sort of summed up this theory with one line that I liked a lot. He said, you know, at the end of the day, we tend to buy things based on how they make us feel, right? And when my students do their projects and they're coming up with messaging ideas for their campaign, that's my challenge to them. Not what do you want your audience to think when they hear your message? What do you want them to feel? What visceral emotion are you trying to get them to express? I don't know that we'll be able to show this video well without the mics. Or did you? Oh, you got some hack. Woohoo. This is a video of Steve Jobs at an internal meeting at Apple when he returned to Apple, right? So he founded Apple with Wozniak. He was ousted by the board. He started Next Computer. Apple bought Next Computer. He came back, and this was right before the meteoric rise of Apple. Right? The audio is not great. I think this version I have has subtitles, which is good. And he's talking about the ad, The Crazy Ones, which is, it was one of their blockbuster ads, which really drove their business. And I'll show you that ad in a moment.
To me, marketing is about value. This is a very complicated world. It's a very noisy world. And we're not going to get a chance to get people to remember much about us. No company is. And so we have to be really clear on what we want them to know about us. Now, Apple, fortunately, is one of the half a dozen best brands in the whole world, right up there with Nike, Disney, Coke, Sony. It is one of the greats of the greats, not just in this country, but all around the globe. And but even a great brand needs investment and caring if it's going to retain its relevance and vitality. And the Apple brand has clearly suffered from neglect in this area in the last few years. And we need to bring it back. The way to do that is not to talk about speeds and feeds. It's not to talk about MIPS and megahertz. It's not to talk about why we're better than Windows. The dairy industry tried for 20 years to convince you that milk was good for you. It's a lie, but they tried anyway. And the sales were going like this. And then they tried Got Milk, and the sales are going like this. Got Milk doesn't even talk about the product. Matter of fact, it focuses on the absence of the product. But the best example of all, and one of the greatest jobs of marketing in the universe has ever seen, is Nike. Remember, Nike sells a commodity. They sell shoes. And yet, when you think of Nike, you feel something different than a shoe company. And their ads, as you know, they don't ever talk about the product. They don't ever tell you about their air soles and why they're better than Reebok's air soles. What does Nike do in their advertising? They honor great athletes, and they honor great athletics. That's who they are. That's what they are about. Apple spends a fortune on advertising. You'd never know it. You'd never know it. So when I got here, Apple just fired their agency. We were doing a competition with 23 agencies that, you know, 4 years from now would pick one. And we blew that up, and we hired Shiatte, the ad agency that I was fortunate enough to work with years ago. We created some award-winning work, including the commercial bug of the best ad ever made in 1984 by advertising professionals. And we started working about 8 weeks ago. And the question we asked was, our customers want to know who is Apple and what is it that we stand for? Where do we fit in this world? And what we're about isn't making boxes for people to get their jobs done, although we do that well. We do that better than almost anybody in some cases. But Apple's about something more than that. Apple, at the core, its core value, is that we believe that people with passion can change the world for the better. That's what we believe. And we've had...
So the video goes on, but that's sort of the key piece I wanted you to see. If you don't know the Crazy Ones ad, here is the ad.
Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
Doesn't tell you anything about the brand, doesn't tell you anything about the products they make, why their products are better or different or less expensive or more expensive. They don't tell you anything about a rational purchase decision. All they communicate to you is what they want you to feel when you think about Apple. Right? One of the most successful ads they ever ran. Do you know this brand, Dos Equis? Dos Equis beer, right? Launched in 2008 in the U.S. When they launched, they had 261 competitors. You talk about defining your competitive set. That's a big competitive set. That competitive set had a combined spend of over $1 billion in media support. And they were this tiny Mexican brand owned by Heineken with zero brand awareness in the U.S. The agency's brief to them was establish a distinctive, desirable, premium identity where people will say it's different from other brands, it's cool, and it's worth paying more for. Right? I'll show you the ad first. This was the launch spot. I'm sure you've seen these.
He wouldn't be afraid to show his feminine side, if he had one. His mother has a tattoo that reads, "Son." At museums, he's allowed to touch the art. He is the most interesting man in the world.
I don't always drink beer, but when I do, I prefer Dos Equis. Stay thirsty, my friends.
Hugely successful campaign, which ran for over 10 years. In a market that was down with imports, Dos Equis was up 32%. In 9 months, they went from shipping zero cases to a million cases of beer, and nobody knew what the beer was about. They didn't know what it tasted like. They didn't know where it came from. They didn't know anything about it. They didn't talk about cold filtered. They didn't talk about refreshing and barley and hops and all this stuff that no one really knows what it means. All they did talk about is what you're going to feel if you use this brand. Right? I know some of the people who did the research on this, which was research ethnographies in bars, which is a really good gig if you can land that one. And what they did was they were observing their target audience, 21 to 29-year-old men. And they observed that when men get together, they play this little game called Can You Top This, right? So one guy goes, hey, man, last weekend I blah, 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 blah. And the next guy goes, that's nothing, man. I once did that with da-da, right? And it keeps going to, like, who's the most interesting guy, right? There's an old saying that guys socialize by making fun of each other, but they don't really mean it. Women socialize by complimenting each other, but they don't mean it either. But what they noticed is that if they just put a mirror up and said, listen, they know that being the most interesting guy is a desirable thing among this target. If you buy this brand that no one has ever heard of and you come out with this cool Dos Equis, you're suddenly the most interesting guy in the bar. They never talked about the brand. And they never talked about the product at all. Just what they want you to feel. Here's an example of your subconscious at work, okay? Read this to yourselves. Native English speakers have an easier time than non-native English speakers, but even non-native can do this pretty well. Okay, ready? Most of you can read that. So you're actually not reading that with your rational mind. You're reading that subconsciously. It's something called pattern metaphor elicitation. All right? They actually use this as one of the diagnostic tools for understanding autism spectrum disorder. Autism spectrum disorder, one of the hallmarks of it is hyper-rationality. There is yes and not yes, black and white. There is no gray. And they read the first line and they see 7 high 5, and they say, that doesn't make sense, and they stop. But you're reading it through your subconscious. Facebook did a really interesting test on this about 4 years ago. Got themselves in a boatload of trouble for doing it because they didn't tell people they were doing it. But in essence, what they did is they took one group of people, you may have been one of them, I don't know, and they altered what your friends' posts that were showing up on your stream. Right? So for one group of people, they minimized positive news from your friends. So you saw an unusually negative stream of stuff coming in from your friends. And another group, they did the opposite. They minimized negative stuff from your friends, so you saw an overly positive response from your friends, just what your friends were posting about. And then they observed what you posted. So does the context within which you live change how you behave, even though you're not aware that the context has changed? Yeah? And here's the data. It's probably hard to read from the back. But when they reduced negativity, right, the number of positive words you posted, because things got more positive, went up. When your friends were more positive, you got more positive, and you got less negative. when positivity was reduced, your friend's posts that you saw were more about broken legs and missed flights, you started becoming more negative. You got less positive, you got more negative. People's behavior changed because of their context, and they had no idea that the context with which they were living changed. What it says is don't hang out with bummer people, because they will have an effect on you. You will change that way, right? But people make decisions and do things and they don't even know it. We see the data. When the data comes out, when we measure the effectiveness of ads, right? Ads with the most emotional response generate a significantly higher lift than brands that are more rational in their messaging. However, brands that do both, they give you an emotional reason to want the brand, and they give you the rational post-justification story. Those are the ones that do the best. But the ones that don't have the emotion, that they're just rational, they don't do nearly as well. And similarly, the emotive power of a brand relative to what the brand's equity is, what the brand stands for, has a very high R-squared coefficient, which is the correlation between those two numbers. So when a brand has a strong emotional appeal, the strength of the brand increases from a sales and a brand equity point of view. I was at a conference recently. He's one of our clients, Kike Pendavis. He's the head of media and advertising for Nestle Corporation. He said this at our meeting, which I loved. He said, make them laugh, make them cry, but for God's sake, make them feel something, because change comes from feelings, not from facts. And then my favorite quote, Maya Angelou, I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel. Right? And just like it is with interpersonal relationships, the relationship that two people have is no different than the relationship you have with a brand. It's the same mechanisms, it's the same body parts we're using to have that relationship. It's the subconscious brain that has that relationship. It's the same way. Brands know this in their logos, right? FedEx hid the arrow in their logo to mean we are moving forward, right? The Tour de France has the bike rider in the middle of their logo. These are all things talking to people at a very subconscious level. We all know that Amazon has the smile. What I never knew rationally is what that meant. It means we sell everything from A to Z. Yeah. Tostitos has the people eating Tostitos in the middle, and Hershey's hides a little Hershey's kiss in their logo, right? These are all subtle attempts to build subconscious associations in people's minds with brands, because those subconscious associations direct us in certain ways when we make decisions. Okay, there we go. So, what questions might you have? Yes. So a lot of times we're trying to think about, one, what are the associations we're trying to build with a brand? What do we want people, when we say the brand name, what do we want them to quickly associate with us? And we're thinking about what are the rational drivers in the category and what are the emotional drivers in the category? Who else is talking about what in the category, and how can we be different from a rational and an emotional point of view? Then we do the research to understand those, and we bake those in to the advertising. Sure. Yeah. Yep. Everything's got a deadline. Everything's got a deadline, right? So we were talking about last night, when we're working on a pitch, for a new piece of business, normally the deadline is anywhere between 2 and 6 weeks. You got to bake the whole thing and ice it and put it out there. For a existing client, normally the timeline is longer, but there are certainly timelines and schedules that need to be met because the client has an on-air date or a launch date for a new campaign, and you got to have everything ready for that. So part of what the account management team does is they try and make sure everything's happening when it should be happening such that you meet that campaign launch date. Yeah. Feel like a game show host? All the time. We never hear it's too emotional, but what we often hear is it's not rational enough. Right? It's the opposite.
It works now.
It's they want a very rational sort of message, what we call RTBs, reasons to believe, right? 10% more whitening power, 50% more cleaning power, now with Oxidol, right? They want things like that because they think those are motivating, and they are when you're talking about it rationally. But from an emotional point of view, they do nothing because your competitors are saying the same stuff generally, right? So it's a constant battle with clients to try and get them to do the right thing. Every once in a while, you get a client that's very brave. It's funny because a lot of clients will say to us, they'll use this phrase, make me uncomfortable, which means push it out into the emotional space, right? But what I've learned over time is how you define uncomfortable matters a lot, right? Because when you say make me uncomfortable to an ad agency person, they automatically go to like waterboarding. And the client's talking about like tight shoes, you know? And there's like a gulf between those. So you have to sort of define what that is. But I have found that the clients that are the bravest, that are willing to push that out, that feel it, those, they're very few and far between, but when they do it, they're like the rock stars in the marketing world.
And one more question. Have you ever done boring ads?
Yeah, sure.
Because of clients? So.
Usually, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
They, you know, and look, they're the ones paying the bill, you know, so it's our job to deliver what they want. It's also our job to tell them what we think would be better than that, but at the end, they're deciding, they're the client, so okay. So we told you what we thought, you want to do this, okay, we go with that.
Thank you.
Sure.
I was really intrigued by that vocabulary game you played with us at the beginning, and it dawns on me that as this country in particular becomes much more multicultural, what are the implications for students to, or how do you expand your awareness of emotion-evoking words that might mean something in one culture but not in another, or could even have the opposite effect?
I don't know how you do it within a market, right? I mean, we struggle with this all the time because we have global brands, right? So I talked about it last night, the Listerine Bold campaign, Are You Bold? That term bold plays very well here in the US. People understand what it means. It's sort of desirable to be a bold person. But in some markets, Japan, that was not a desirable thing. It's not desirable to be seen as bold. It's undesirable, right? So we had to change it a bit to be something else. I don't really know. That's a good question. I don't know how you deal with that in one market where people have different terms that mean different things. I don't know. I have to think about that. That's interesting.
Okay. Good question.
Yeah. Testing, I guess.
I don't remember the papers, and I'll have to send you some, but there's some early psychological stuff that lends credibility to your feel, think, do with top-down versus bottom-up processing. And it's the old thought experiment of, do you cry because you are sad, or are you sad because you were crying? And intuitively, we all think we start crying because we are sad, but there's some great research that actually says it's the opposite, that you feel yourself cry, and then you become sad.
I love it.
So But that's a lot of that stuff has been moved into top-down versus bottom-up processing.
Right. Right.
Not really a question, just a...
No, I'd love to see it. I think that's true.
Can you talk a little bit about... I don't even need
this. Can you talk a little bit about... For the web.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about how research has changed, the research that you do has changed in terms of what you tend to do now, maybe before you're launching a campaign, or what you tend to do as you're measuring effectiveness and kind of how those metrics have changed?
Yeah, creating a campaign hasn't changed much other than we can do it significantly faster than we ever did in the past and significantly less expensive. So what used to take, you know, 6 months and $100,000 can now be done in 6 weeks for $20,000, right? And that's just technology that has allowed us to do that. Measuring the effectiveness of ads is still really, really tricky and bedeviling, right? Because proving causality is a hard thing to do, right? There are some companies that are offering some techniques now that for the first time are using what we call single source data. So it used to be you spent $40 million on media for your campaign, and you looked at how many people bought your product, and you made a correlation between those, even though you don't know that this caused that, but you sort of made some assumptions that it did. What some of these companies are doing, and TiVo is one of them. Anyone know TiVo? You guys are too young for that. Yeah, somebody did. TiVo was the first DVR that was out there, right? And they sold hardware for your house. They still sell hardware, but they're largely out of the hardware business. They're in the data business now. So what they're doing is they know who's watching what in your household, and therefore what ads you're seeing, and they're merging that with online data to know what ads you were served online, what content you saw, what PR you ingested. Then they're going out and they're buying supermarket loyalty card data, right? And supermarket loyalty card data, you all think you're getting discounts and that's the nice part of it. That's a value exchange because they're collecting your data. They're tracking exactly what you buy at the store every week. And they are merging these databases together. They're not fusing them, which is what had been done in the past. They're actually merging them. So they know in Frauke's household, this is what you watched on TV. This is what you then bought in the store at the household level. And they can see how many times did you have to see the ad before we saw a shift in behavior, right? If you used to buy only Prego spaghetti sauce and now you saw a Ragu ad, how many times did you have to see the Ragu ad before one of those 10 purchases became Ragu? And then what happened after that, right, over time? And then if you saw another Prego ad, what happened, right? All this sort of really interesting stuff, but for the first time, they're actually able to look at it. In the digital world, it's much easier to measure effect. If assuming that your effect is a digital effect, go to the website, click on something, make a purchase online. If the effect is offline, then it's, again, much trickier to measure the mechanisms for that. But what's going to happen is big data, right, which has all of this promise in the data and marketing world yet to be fulfilled, but I suspect it'll get there. The value is going to be in matching and merging multiple databases together. And then we're going to really have a holistic view of the consumer that we never really have had, but that's going to really help us understand what this marketing activity resulted in over here in terms of sales, I think. Yeah. To buy it?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. There's a couple companies do it. Nielsen, AC Nielsen company who tracks TV stuff, they have a service now that's doing that as well. But it's very expensive. But they're pretty big databases, I think, because TiVo has 20 million installed users, and I think when they match it, they get it down to 2 million. But 2 million households is a pretty good sample to see what's happening. It's cool stuff, isn't it? No, not yet. And that's only because a lot of the global markets just don't have the data sophistication yet. Some do. You know, the big five in Europe, many of them do. Most of Asia doesn't, most of Africa doesn't, Middle East doesn't. So they're all trying to catch up, but there's not as much demand for it in those markets.
Do companies ever try to change their emotional appeal? And are there like risks associated with doing that?
Yeah. Yeah, it's you know, if you, again, BMW, right? If you say BMW to most people, people have a very clear image of what that brand is. And the reason is that for 40 years, they've been the ultimate driving machine. Right, and they haven't wavered from that. But if I say to you General Motors or even Chevrolet, people are sometimes at a loss to tell you what that means because they've been 10 different things over 40 years, right? They were the heartbeat of America, they were open roads, they were freedom, they've been about a lot of different things. And you know, there's an old saying in marketing that if you're multiple things to one person, you're nothing to anybody. Because people don't know who you are. Imagine a friend of yours who every time you saw them, they had sort of a different persona. One day they're the jock guy, next day they're the egghead, then they're the philosopher kind of guy into books and stuff, right? You wouldn't know who they were, right? It's the same thing with brands. They have to be very consistent in the marketing. So there's a lot of danger in changing sort of what your messaging is, which is why it's so important to get it right when you go out into the market.
How long would it take for the consumers to perceive the brand as something else, for the images to change?
It's hard. It's really hard, and it depends on how much money you're going to invest in it, right? So this semester in my class at Columbia, we're studying Gap, the clothing retailer. And the good thing about it is that when you look at the perceptual associations with Gap, there are none. Nobody knows what the brand is anymore. They have no good, no bad, no nothing. They're just kind of there. And I said to this dude, I said, you know, that's a good thing. Because you don't have to sort of undo some other emotional baggage that's not working. You have a plain canvas. You can sort of paint a brand new picture on that. So that's a good thing. When you do have a positioning that's not working, then it's significantly harder. And you can do it. It's just going to cost a lot of money and take a fair amount of time, which could be 3 years and $200 million to get there. It could be harder.